The countdown is on for WWE WrestleMania week in Orlando. Join us at the WrestleCon FanFest Friday, March 31st and Saturday, April 1st with over 150 top superstars and WWE legends available for autographs and posed photos. At the MWF booth, meet Shelton Benjamin, Zeb Coulter, and John Cena Sr. both days. For discount pre-sale tickets, visit bostonwrestling.com.
This is Mick Foley.
This is Harley Race.
This is Shelton Benjamin.
This is Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
This is the Monster Abyss.
And this is Daniel Bryan.
This is JBL, and you're watching the MWF.
Be there live.
Welcome to a special installment of Boston Wrestling Sports Wrestling Insiders Theories. I'm Dan Marotti. Great program planned for you. Now, very rarely in wrestling do you find someone with a lot of talent that's a great guy and a great guy that's got a lot of talent. When you do, you know you're pretty lucky. And I'm very happy to have with me the man that's bringing the Beyond Body Slams tour across the eastern part of the United States, my friend, Gary Michael Capetta. Gary, pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. It's great to be back up in New England.
Saturday night, February the 25th, everybody's talking about it, Clark University, Worcester, Massachusetts, almost 25 years after the March of 92 house show they had at the Centrum with WCW. You're back, the book comes to life with you.
Yes, sir. I am so excited because it's been about 10 years since I've been in New England.
Mm-hmm.
And the last time I was here, I was doing backstage interviews with Ring of Honor. And of course, people know that I started with WWF, which became the WWE eventually, and everything in between. I was up here with the NWA at times. I was up here with the Savoldis on independent wrestling.
This is a name to throw back out at the fans, right?
There
Long
you go.
Now.
and then I was up here with Ring of Honor. So I decided Worcester was the city because the guys from Boston can come over, the folks from Springfield can be there, the Providence, Rhode Island folks, and the people from Connecticut.
Yeah, Hartford, Connecticut's not that far away either. It's a great central location.
And New Hampshire. So therefore, I decided Clark University is the place. And my stage show is going to be unpredictable. It's going to be zany. I'm going to take my book, Body Slams, and I'm going to rip it apart. And you're going to find out things that are in it and things that I didn't mention because I couldn't mention it there.
Fantastic book. If you don't have a copy of it yet and you're not in an area close to the Body Slam, Beyond Body Slam store, Amazon.com, I'm sure is a great place to pick up your autobiography.
Yeah.
But experiencing the show, like you said, it's different than that. Not only do you get in-depth inside the book itself, but like you said, there's so much more. You probably could have written three or four autobiographies at this point.
And this is true. And I'm not only going to be telling stories, but I am.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not just going to be doing a question and answer, but I am. It's a set piece. It's sort of like a wrestling match, where I have certain points that I'm going to hit. And through storytelling and giant video, I'm going to show you some backstage scenes that are rarely seen, things from when we were on tour, and video and so forth, and also my greatest hits. The night Mick Foley lost his ear, the night that Sid and Arn got into a knife fight in England. So a lot of different things. Well, it's going to be unpredictable.
Not to be confused with Johnny Rods.
No.
You talk about unpredictable. The book originally came out, was it 2001?
2000.
2000. So popular it was re-released by ECW Press a few years later. As time has gone on now, almost pushing 20 years, what is the feedback to your story in print been like?
You know what? So many books have come out since this book. This was the second book published of the modern era of an inside wrestler kind of book.
Mm-hmm.
The first was Mick Foley's book.
Mm-hmm.
This was written before Mick Foley's book, but his came out first. You have to take it with perspective. Remembering I'm not a wrestler, so I had a different view of how things were run and how the guys behaved and the business of pro wrestling. So it's different in that way. It's got a different perspective. And it also has to be read with the idea of somebody who wrote it in the year 2000, and then I added to it in 2005. It's not a slam book by any means. There are some things that I don't like that certain people have done, and I do talk about that. But when the second edition came out, I gave everybody an opportunity who I had anything a little negative to say, an opportunity to write and rebut what I said. Vince McMahon had an opportunity, Mick Foley had an opportunity, Jim Cornette had an opportunity, and some people took that opportunity and wrote.
Really?
Yeah. So when you look at the new edition, I had and Jim Cornette was right. I had mischaracterized an incident that had happened in Pennsylvania when he had taken his racket, and he just smashed a guy
in
the nose.
Hit the guy coming over the guardrail?
Right. Okay, he was protecting himself. My mistake was I characterized the guy as an old guy, and he wasn't. He was a young guy. He was in his 30s. He looked like he was in his 60s, but he was in his 30s. Mick Foley didn't like a couple of descriptions I gave, so he wrote. And I promised them, you would have the last word. So that makes this book unique.
Great. Like I said, the honesty in the book, it's one of the best that I've read out of all the plethora of books. And usually you remember what comes out first, like you said, the Foley book, when there didn't appear to be a wrestling book coming out every month, every other month, like there is now. But your book still stands the test of time, even if it did come out in the year 2000 in the re-release. I think it was 2006 that ECW Press put it out again. So many great stories about, as I like to say, I hate to use the phrase when wrestling was good, but when it was a lot more enjoyable to a larger percentage of the population. I think right now, and I don't know if you agree or disagree, I'll throw it out to you. Yep. I think there are a lot more people that like wrestling that don't watch it now than do watch it now.
I never thought about that. I'm not one of those old guys that said, oh, everything in the past was horrible. And or everything in the past was great, and what's going on now is horrible. I'm not like that at all. I support indie wrestling. That's the future of our business. I do think that it's unfortunate that you have great training facilities around the country that teach the guys what they need to know. And then they go to a TNA or sometimes a WWE and they're taught other things. They have to do other things. They're not being instinctual. They're being scripted. Whereas when they're doing more local wrestling, it's, you know, they're taught to make it up as they go along as far as their promos and their interviews. And sometimes when you get to the major leagues, it's a little bit too scripted, in my opinion.
I don't want to body slam wrestling as a whole right now, no pun intended, but when you just look at the number of people that would go to live events, the number of people that watch on television, as it seems to go now almost decade to decade, it's pretty scary. Everyone likes to romanticize the Attitude Era, which was great for cable television.
Right.
But if you compare that to the number of bodies that were watching television in the 80s and going to live event in the 80s, you can't compare the two. For what it was great. But imagine if there was an Attitude Era before WWF took over and you had cable numbers like that all over the country.
You know, I make a parallel between the circus and pro wrestling. Ringling Brothers and WWE. And in both cases, they tried to broaden their appeal. And as soon as they tried to broaden their appeal, they, the product itself, the nitty-gritty wrestling that I loved, that I came to be enamored with, that was lost. It got, not that it shouldn't have changed with the times, but the product itself. So look what happened to Ringling Brothers now. Ringling Brothers
isn't that crazy?
It's out of business.
I couldn't believe it when I read that.
First they did away with the three rings. So then they became like Disney on Ice show.
Yeah.
Then they did away with the elephants. And as soon as they did away with the elephants, people stopped going. And it didn't take long for them to... What the WWE has that they didn't have was TV. And
Right?
Because when I was a kid, I used to go to the circus to see stars. Emmett Kelly, the clown. And Gunther Gable Williams, the lion tamer. They don't have the ability to create stars as the WWE does.
Right.
And WWE is very smart because if everything just fell away with USA Network, they're creating their own network.
They have their own.
And it's just very, very smart, because if they don't have that, then they're not going to be able to introduce, create stars, create storylines, try to create interest in their product. So that, oh, we're just going to see wrestling. No. Just like, whoa, we're just going to see the circus. Not really. You know, that's not enough to draw people. There are just too many different entertainment venues that people have, you know, that they can experience. You need something special.
I think what WWE does right now is fantastic, but it only appeals to a limited number of people. Mm-hmm. I think there were just so many more diehard fans that love something so different, and I think there's room for a lot of variety. If you go to the movie theater nowadays, you figure there's, what, 10 different movies playing. They're all about something different. I think there's room for a lot more different wrestling, especially where WWE now has a variety of brands. Instead of presenting something similar with all three that they have on, and four now with the Cruiserweight show that they offer, I'd like to see a little bit more variety, but mm-hmm.
And I do
call
think
me old, I don't know.
I think it's a mistake, too, to for the performers, for the wrestlers to get a bad rap. They're doing what they're being asked to do.
Right. They're just going with how it's asked to be executed.
Right. They wouldn't be there unless they had mastered their craft on the indie level. But then they make it to USA and TV, and then they're asked to do something else.
Right.
Because I've been particularly impressed with the ladies' division. Sasha and Flair.
Charlotte, Becky Lynch.
Yeah.
Nia Jax that's on TV
they're
now.
Excellent. Now, let's talk about old school and these young ladies.
Sure.
We had Moolah. What did Moolah do? Moolah kicked. Moolah bit. Moolah raked eyes. Moolah very...
She did the spot with the hair, throwing them across
right,
the ring.
Very rarely did you see a wrestling hold.
Right.
So if I were to be honest about it and compare wrestling from the 70s and the 60s and wrestling now, the young ladies today, they wrestle.
They're more
competitive, they're more physical, they're more intellectual with what they're doing.
Athletic.
Athletic.
Not to take anything away from the ladies of yesteryear, but
it's a different
these
style.
Are real deal athletes that are out there now, on par with the men in a lot of ways.
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm pretty impressed. What I get lost with, and I don't watch WWE every week, mm-hmm. is I guess because they're taking on like a reality theme with all of their angles.
Yeah.
Everybody seems regular. Everybody, there's some guys that seem alike, that look alike, that like a Roman Reigns, like with the wet, dark hair. And then who's the other guy with the wet?
Seth Rollins.
Yeah, I mean, unless you looked at the tattoos, I couldn't tell the difference between the two guys.
Yeah.
If I'm sitting up in the rafters and looking down, I don't know.
When you have the same people trying to come up with the characteristics and creativity for everyone on an entire roster,
yeah,
you can see how it can get.
But it was always that case. You know, Vince McMahon Sr. was the one person coming up with all the characters, and Jim Crockett was coming up with all the characters with Dusty. And, nah, that's not an excuse. It's just, I don't know, they just want to keep it more real.
And safe. They don't like to really...
That's
escape those boundaries in 2017, at least.
Well, that's true. I mean, you can't do some... Well, I wouldn't say you can't do, but they won't do some of the things that were done in the old days. Like, you're not ordinarily going to see, like, a Kevin Sullivan
right.
kind of other world worshiper and treat his lady the way he did and dragged her around by her hair. I might try it if I was running the promotion, because I think that would get people's attention. But then I'd also have to put up with the politically correct, probably protesters outside my arenas, which is what happened with Ringling Brothers.
Yeah. Well, let me ask you this now. As an old-time fan that was, you know, you had a better seat than the front row fans
yeah.
for thousands upon thousands of events.
Yep.
Do you think that wrestling needs to be a little bit more violent in 2017 in some aspects to approach and please maybe a demographic they're not really hitting right now?
Maybe not violent, but maybe edgy.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe edgy. Maybe to go different places where, quite honestly, they're afraid to go. And I think they could give me a very, you know, very good list of reasons as to why they don't go there. Because everybody's so super sensitive. I mean,
it's the entire world. It's not just wrestling.
No matter what you do, right. you're going to offend somebody.
Maybe people need to be offended a little.
wrestling always did.
Yeah, and it survived and it thrived.
Right.
I just think it's too safe. I love what WWE does when it's done well. It's fantastic. It's something I don't think I ever expected to see when I started watching it when I was a little kid. But I just think it's too repetitive. And like you says, it needs to be a little bit more of an edge to it. If they want to have one show that's similar to how WWE runs right now, I think that's great, because I think it's awesome that they have a product for kids to watch. Because during the 90s and into the early 2000s, I know I wouldn't want my ex's oldest kid to see it. And that bothered me, because I loved wrestling. I was involved in wrestling. I could get tickets to any event on the planet, but I didn't want him to see bra and panties and those type things.
You know, but if you present a thoughtful product, like Ric Flair back in the day, he was edgy, and he was saying things that went right over the heads of kids.
Oh, yeah, right?
You know what I'm saying? Yep. So there are ways to do it.
Sure.
Where it's not in your face, but we all as adults know what he's talking about. But, you know, kids are thinking about Space Mountain and the you know.
They're thinking of the Disney ride, right?
Yeah. It's totally, it can be done. And I agree. I wouldn't be afraid of offending people.
Maybe not everything they do, but like I said, they have four different shows now. They have their own network. There's room. There's movie companies. They have G movies. They have PG movies. They have PG-13, R-rated movies. There's a chance to have some variety, you know, and please more people.
Don't see a reason when I watch the product that I don't see that the characters having so much of a reason to win a match.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It's just not clean cut that way.
And I complained about this the other night when it was on TV. It was a good match. But when they just throw out champions now without announcing non-title matches, and they have them take pinfalls. So if they don't present that as something important or unique to build up to an actual championship defense, the psychology behind that really confuses me.
Yeah, or if a championship is going to flip over and over and over again.
Yeah.
You know, then of what importance does it have?
For a while, that was a real problem. And I have to say, WWE is 10 times better than they were maybe a decade ago, mm-hmm. when they just throw the championship belt around like it was a hot potato. And I think it killed it for a few years.
Now, that being said, I have a great deal of respect for the wrestlers.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And what they do. And
they're just going out and working.
Yeah. They're doing what they're instructed to do. They can do so much more, and they can do so much better.
And if they're not going 110%, they're going to find someone who is. So all the props in the world to the guys and the girls that are going out there week in and week out, putting their, you know, physical well-being on the line to make so many people happy across the world. But as far as just the must-see reason to tune in each and every week, or leave your house, get away from Netflix, the internet, charge up that smartphone to go to the arena, spend money on a ticket, parking, the crazy money for food nowadays. I don't know what the must-see reason is, Gary, and that really worries me.
Yeah, because the issue I have is with their creative side,
yeah,
or lack of creativity.
Mm-hmm. It worries me. I want everybody that gets into wrestling, that does it the right way and really puts forth an honest effort, I want everybody to succeed. I want everybody to do well. Imagine, you know, the old saying, what's old is new again. Imagine if the greatest thing that Vince McMahon could do, either on purpose or even by accident, would be to set up a system where, with his network, it's almost a little mini territory system created again with all these little different touring companies. Two weekends ago, when they did that tournament, I don't know if you're familiar with it, over in England, to crown the WWE UK champion, they ran five cities the same night between two WWE, two NXT, and then they had the tournament over in England. If they could get that many people working and having full-time jobs again, it'd be great. I'd just like to see, again, more variety, something different.
Yeah. I would like to see a combination of today's athletes, the wrestlers of today, with the edginess and the characters of yesterday.
The quote-unquote good old days.
If you were to put those two things together, because once again, I do not believe that yesterday was great and today is horrible. I don't. They're too careful.
I'll tell you something that isn't going to be careful, something that is going to be outside the box.
I know.
Saturday, February the 25th, a wonderful liberal arts college, I'm told about by our friend Captain Chris, Clark University, Worcester, Massachusetts, Beyond Body Slams. We talked about the great book that wasn't released just once, but twice. This isn't just the first time you've toured, Gary. Tell us a little bit about the first time you went out and about.
The first time I went out, I started down in Newport News, Virginia,
mm-hmm.
Christopher Newport University.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the very first time that this concept was presented. Because you do have like Mick Foley, who's at comedy clubs. You have JR that goes out, does Q&As. You have Jake the Snake, you have Van Damme. And mostly what they do are Q&As. And any fan that I've talked to who's gone out to see them has had a good time and has enjoyed them. This is different. It's I'll probably end with a Q&A, but it's a set piece stage show. And I'm taking stories from the book and I'm bringing them to life through storytelling, through giant video. And at the end, it's just one story. It's just one person's story of how he came to love pro wrestling. But it's an interactive show, and I'm going to be talking with the audience. And the overarching theme is our love for pro wrestling, how we became fans. Not just me, but everybody who comes out and joins the show.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's a part of it. So I'm looking forward to it.
Why? Where did the idea from to come back on tour again in 2017? What made you wake up one morning and say, you know what? There's a lot of fans that would really enjoy this. Let me start the process of going to these 9 different cities that you're going to be hitting throughout February and March.
Because I didn't complete the mission back when I first presented it. I also did the show for the Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame induction years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And yeah, I just didn't finish it. I didn't really give it a full test.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll be, before I come here to Worcester, I'll be in Philadelphia, I'll be in Scranton. After Worcester on the 25th of February, I go to Indianapolis, Chicago, Greensboro, Pittsburgh, Baltimore, and I wind up down in Orlando.
For the fans that are seeing this, you know, talk about 10 years ago when we were only on television, now we have the benefit of the internet. We're going to have the dates and the locations scrolling, as well as the Facebook, where you can get all the information from Gary himself. But for the visually impaired, it's good to know exactly where you might be in case they want to come out and listen to it. Are you going to hit any of the same cities that you hit the first go around?
No.
Or are they all new?
These are all new.
Really? Okay.
These are all new cities. And I have another set of cities in the back of my mind for another tour.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's great.
So, yeah. It's an inexpensive ticket.
Mm-hmm.
I do want to encourage everyone to buy their tickets in advance because the night of the show, the prices go up. And there's no reason to spend more. And all the tickets can be found at eventbrite.com.
And just to give out the Facebook link, I want to make sure I have the right one. It's facebook.com/GMC4Real. That's what I thought it was.
GMC for real.
I don't have my glasses on, so I didn't want
to. You can do that too. You can go to the events page. And you'll find all of the cities, including the big one in Worcester.
Now, I'm familiar with some of the venues that you're running. You said get your tickets early. These are intimate settings, Gary. These aren't arenas.
No, no.
They're not even venues you might see an independent wrestling show at that can fit 300 or 400
people.
That's
another thing that I'm concerned about.
This is almost like this TV studio. I mean, these people are going to be within several feet of you.
That's right. They're very intimate settings. 80, 90, 100 seats. Worcester's a little bit larger.
Mm-hmm.
But that's one concern I have, is that wrestling fans are used to waiting and getting to an arena, buying a ticket, because you can always add more rows
right.
at a wrestling show. But these are theaters.
You can't take the wall down, Gary.
No, I cannot do that. So I want to be sure that everyone that wants to go doesn't get shut out. So if they could just pick up their tickets in advance, we'll know that there'll be a place for you.
Save a few bucks. Then you don't have to worry about the real dilemma of actually making your plans, time to go out to attend the event. You get to the building, and there's just physically no space.
That's right.
Because again, this studio is a great intimate setting for an interview like this. And I can't imagine that, you know, maybe double the size of this, some of those theaters that you're going to be in.
You're absolutely right.
You pick some great places, Gary.
Yeah. There's a place in Indianapolis. It's called the Irving Theater.
Mm-hmm.
They actually have a stage that... The claim to fame is Elvis Presley actually performed on this stage.
Really?
Now, I don't know whether...
I'm going to guess it was a very young Elvis. young Elvis.
I have no idea.
I can't imagine Elvis was playing too many 100-seat theaters when he hit his peak.
Originally, when I had booked Clark University, it was going to be even a smaller venue. It was their Black Box Theater, which only seats 80, 90 people.
Oh, wow.
And then they had a conflict, and they said, would you mind going to Razzo Hall? That's another thing. People need to, who are coming to the show, just check out the geography, because if you come into on campus at the other end, that's not going to work out too well. If you go in on Downing Street, the theater is right off the the public thoroughfare. So, but yeah, and it's at eventbrite.com is where they need to go to pick up tickets.
And again, it's not like you're going to sit there and watch a professional wrestling event, and there's nothing wrong with that. We all love it, obviously.
Right.
But it's the interaction. It's not just an event. It's almost like an experience.
Yes.
Is the way I'd like to describe it.
A lot of surprises. You see, here's the interesting thing. People are used to seeing me and hearing me mostly say a weight, a place, and a name. Most people, until I started doing podcasts or these kinds of interviews, didn't realize, or wrote the book, probably didn't realize there was anything behind that. So there's another side of GMC that people haven't seen.
You were the soundtrack to almost three decades of national professional wrestling, but the lyrics were pretty much the same. Is that a good way to put it?
That's a very good way to put it. It's an excellent way to put it, yes.
Well, I know I love the book, and just after seeing some clips of the actual stage show from its first incarnation, I think the fans are going to be in for a real treat. Again, like we talked about on the phone, you only have a limited amount of space.
That's
and
right.
I think everybody's really going to enjoy it. If you enjoyed the proverbial good old days of professional wrestling, from someone that loved it too, I know you're going to enjoy it. If you like wrestling nowadays, you're going to enjoy it because there's so many stories, not only from the WWWF days, the WCW days, NWA, AWA, but you even had the run with Ring of Honor.
With
and look
Ring
at
of
where
Honor.
So many of those young guys went and where they are right now.
Think about it. When I was doing the backstage interviews with Ring of Honor, it was Brian Danielson, who was Daniel Bryan, was CM Punk, it was Colt Cabana, it was Nigel McGuinness, it was Styles, AJ Styles, Samoa Joe. Like, what a roster. I mean, just as you said, look where those guys went. And it was a thrill for me to work with these guys, and because they were kind of still finding their way with interview skills. So we would retake. We had an opportunity to be sure to hone those skills, to teach them at a certain point. And then now for them to become international stars, to me that's thrilling. And that's why at each stop of my tour, I'm teaming up with a wrestling promotion. And up here in New England, it's Chaotic Wrestling. I had an association with Chaotic Wrestling back when the book first came out. I gave a talk there. In fact, it was the night before I came to your show.
October of 2002, down at the Mirakel Civic Center in Wakefield.
And I made a lot of friends, and I was also associated with a Delaware promotion. It was Jim Kettner's promotion.
Talk about some history from them, right?
Yeah, and as a result, it was a beautiful thing because they were able to exchange talent.
Yeah.
Because I introduced one to the other, and it worked out really well.
Nothing is better for the independent talent, quote unquote, than to go to different places with different people and learn different things, in my opinion.
So many of the stars of Chaotic, I've invited them to come to my stage show in Worcester. And they'll be there at Clark University. People can come by, they can chat with them, they can find out about how these guys got trained, they can get tips, or they can get autographs. And who knows, I'm telling you, it's gonna be unpredictable. So I just may call out a couple of the guys and bring them on stage.
All right, we'll have to wait and see. But, and that's not just in Worcester. Again, if you're watching this online, if you might be going to Scranton, Pennsylvania or Indianapolis, you're working with folks all over the country.
That's right. And that wasn't a blind tease. I really don't know what I'm going to do.
Okay.
It just depends on, you
your
know,
mood.
What like what strikes me or, you know, if someone like looks at me and I don't like it, or what, I may call them out and just bring them on stage.
All right. Well, you are the world's most dangerous ring announcer.
We may find out why,
may find out why. You may have a second coming in UFC, but that's a different story for a different time. Why don't we take a break right now? There's so much great stuff to talk about in your career. I think the fans are going to love it. I don't know. I always take notes, even though I never really wind up using them, because the conversations just go off in so many different crazy roads, you know?
Sounds good to me.
Sounds good. We're going to take a brief time out. We'll be back with more about the Beyond Body Slams tour with the one and only Gary Michael Capetta. Stand by.
Are you part of a nonprofit organization looking to raise cash for your cause? Don't settle for cheap imitations. After this video, learn how you can bring the action and excitement of the Millennium Wrestling Federation to your town live to help put the fun into fundraising with the superstars and legends of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This winter, don't miss Gary Michael Capetta's Beyond Body Slams event when it comes to your city live. Fun, informative, controversial, Beyond Body Slams is an insider's romp through professional wrestling with backstage video and stories from Gary's Body Slams autobiography. The tour kicks off February the 19th in Philadelphia, Friday, February 24th in Scranton, Pennsylvania, Saturday, February the 25th in Worcester, Massachusetts, Saturday, March the 4th in Indianapolis, Indiana, Sunday, March the 5th in Chicago, Illinois, Sunday, March the 12th in Greensboro, North Carolina, Saturday, March 18th in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, Saturday, March the 25th in Baltimore, Maryland, culminating WrestleMania weekend at WrestleCon in Orlando, Florida. Visit facebook.com/GMCForReal for complete event information. From WWE to the NWA, from WCW to Ring of Honor, every company and every superstar in between, Gary Michael Capetta brings it to life in Beyond Body Slams Live. The Millennium Wrestling Federation's 15th anniversary tour begins this fall and rolls into 2017 throughout New England, down the East Coast, and into the Carolinas. If your nonprofit organization is looking for an interactive, turnkey experience while putting the fun into fundraising, you've met the perfect tag team partner. MWF offers a variety of packages for groups of almost any size, from our live events at the Boston Garden, the Kowloon Entertainment Dining Complex, and the legendary Suffolk Downs, to high school gyms and function halls. We've presented live events everywhere. Since 2001, the MWF's mission has been simple: keep the kids off the streets. Under the leadership of President Dr. David Reese, we bring the superstars of yesterday, today, and tomorrow to your town, not for a quote-unquote wrestling show, but an event that features action-packed in-ring wrestling, autograph and pose photo opportunities, question and answer sessions, and much more. It is the best of sports and entertainment. The week of your event, we can add on to the endeavor with anti-bullying campaigns, library meet and reads, youth sport concussion seminars, and more. Our live events are fit for fans of every age, from 5 to 95. This fall, as part of our new Kids Club program, we offer live event experiences exclusively for the youngest of fans. On the flip side, we can also produce a tailor-made event for fans of an older demographic as well. We work with you every single step of the way to get the word out to fans near and far, on our local television offerings, and to over 50,000 fans and growing on our social media platform. Your success is our success. If your group has had enough of boring candy bar and wrapping paper sales and has the energy to team with our passionate fan base, bringing the MWF experience to your community is the answer to put smiles on faces while raising cash for your cause. Contact us today to get the ball rolling for your custom-made event that you want to bring back year after year. Don't just take it from us. Here are folks we've teamed with in the past.
Wrestling fans, welcome back to our interview with the one and only Gary Michael Capetta. The countdown is on here in the greater Boston, Worcester area, Saturday night, February the 25th. Special 7:35 p.m. start time, Beyond Body Slams, Brock University, Worcester, Mass. And what else is going on that day, Gary?
That is Ric Flair's birthday.
Do you have a robe you're going to wear in Worcester?
You never know. You never know.
The tour is going to be great if you're just tuning in. 9 big cities, but here in the Northeast, you got to be looking forward to Worcester, Massachusetts.
Absolutely. It's always been like home when I come here.
You're a Northeast guy.
I'm a Northeast guy, yeah. I remember stepping into the ring in the old Boston Gardens, you just felt the history of that building. It was just a wonderful, wonderful experience.
Did you announce shows for the WWF, or was it just the NWA ones?
The NWA.
Okay. So the Bash, when they did that up here,
right.
And a couple of
my
other ones.
Big arena with the WWF was the Spectrum.
Okay.
In Philadelphia. I rarely traveled. I went to the Pittsburgh Civic Arena at the time. That was the only time that they asked me to go outside of the area.
Now, I always get a lot of feedback, non-wrestling fans, so to speak, from around the studio when they see these shows and we do them. They always have some interesting comments.
Yep.
I know one we're going to get, I can predict it right now, is that how the hell did a guy like this Gary Capetta, so nice, well-spoken, well-mannered, how the hell did he get involved in professional wrestling?
You see, but that's a misnomer because way back in the beginning when I was 21 and I started announcing, I did a little boxing. We didn't have mixed martial arts back then, but they had tough man competitions. And I did a couple of those, and I said, nah, no way. The wrestlers and the environment in wrestling was so much elevated compared to that. I don't know why people have that idea that wrestling-related people are down and dirty.
It's always been that way.
Nah, they're very, usually very well-educated.
I'm talking about the perception.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it wasn't like that at all. But I will tell you that because I'm not the tallest guy in the world, right?
Right.
Right. Be kind. And I'm all very conservative looking, you know, especially when I have my tux on.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that when Gorilla Monsoon brought me in to begin with, that was part of the attraction of using me, was because I was such a contrast to George the Animal Steel, Jimmy Superfly Snuka, you know, the stars at the
right.
time. I was smaller. I was conservative looking. And that's part of the beauty of this show, is that I'm getting an opportunity to show different sides of GMC. I'm going to surprise people.
I know I'm looking forward to it. I know fans all over the Northeast, all the way from the Northeast all the way down to Orlando, Florida, when the Beyond Body Slam Tour culminates, WrestleMania weekend is part of WrestleCon. I know I'll be there for that one too.
Excellent.
And I'm looking forward to it once again. 9 big stops. I don't know how you're doing it, Gary.
Well,
you have to stock up on the energy drinks.
I'm a road warrior. I love the road. I love driving. Yeah, nothing stops me.
You were thrilled to come up here and talk to people about Worcester. It amazed me.
Absolutely.
Most people, you'd have to get the old clown thing, pull them up by the rope. You were practically pulling me into the studio to get it done. I loved it.
No. I love driving. You know what? It's very therapeutic.
Yeah?
When I'm driving along, put a little music on. In fact, when I'm extra tired, I'll put country music on.
Really?
Because they always tell a story. So that if
keeps
you have,
thinking, right?
Yeah. If you have like a pounding, that's like, that kind of like puts you to sleep. It's like a trance. But if you have a talk radio or country music, there's a story to listen to. Or sometimes I just tune that totally, even though it may be on, and I just think. And there are very few times in our lives, if you think about it, where there's not something, either a person or a television or a computer or a phone, that we're interacting with. So this is one opportunity where it's solitude. You don't have to listen to anyone else. It's just nice being on the road.
For me, that is actually 2 doors down from the studio. When I go to the chiropractor 4 days a week, they put me in this chair at the end that loosens up my neck and my back and my legs. And for 15 minutes, there is no phone, there's no sound. It's
That's
just
right.
peace. Other than the little motor on the chair, it's peace and quiet, a chance to think a little bit. I get what you're saying.
And my favorite time to drive is through the night.
Oh, really? So that works out well tonight, then.
2, 3, 4 in the morning. Oh, yeah.
You're still a night owl?
Absolutely.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you got into teaching when you were still in professional wrestling, right?
Yes.
Okay.
When I started announcing, I started teaching.
Now, how do those two worlds jive?
My students used to watch me on pro wrestling every weekend.
Really?
But we kept it separate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, kids, when I was a kid, I would want to steer the teacher off topic. But I wouldn't allow that. But, you know, in the cafeteria or in the hallway, kids, or before class, after class, you know, they would ask me questions and I would share what I was doing with them.
Now, it must have been really difficult to try and just travel-wise make all the towns and still get up for school in the morning and put in a solid 6+ hours with the kids.
It was most challenging when I did the WWF TVs.
Oh, okay.
Because they went on forever. And usually they were 3.5 hours from home. So as soon as I finished school, I had my tux in my car, jumped in the car, and maybe I would get there within 10 minutes of the start of the program.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Never late, though, I bet.
No. By the grace of God, I was just lucky. Because those tapings started at 6, 6:30.
Oh, that early on a weeknight?
Down in Philadelphia, down in Hamburg. And I was teaching way in the mountains in North Jersey. Yeah, and then afterwards, let's get in the car. And that was why one night, Mr. Fuji was a prankster.
Mm-hmm.
He loved to do anything to disturb your day. And he used to carry locks, you know, like
right,
combination yep. locks. And I don't know why he found it joyful to take one of your personal possessions and lock it to something that was stationary in the locker room. So one night I came back at the end of TV, and my garment bag was, I was lucky that it wasn't stationary, it was locked to a yellow folding chair, a metal yellow folding chair. And I didn't have time to fuss with it. I needed to get back to home so I can get up in the morning.
Right.
So here I am walking down the streets of Philadelphia with this yellow folding chair. I left it in my car, and I sent it down to the shop at school the next day just to ask them to, you know, to...
Were they able to do it for you?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
good, at least. It was only a one-day inconvenience, right? Now, did you always teach Spanish or were other subjects?
Mostly Spanish, yeah. I taught for all of my years when I was with the WWE, WWF,
mm-hmm.
and then I left when I went to WCW.
Oh, okay, you were with WCW wrestling full time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, because in order to travel around the world, there was no way that I could have kept my teaching job. But then when I stopped, I went back to teaching. I actually went back to the same school 4 different times they rehired me.
Really?
Yeah.
Isn't that cool?
It was just it just happened that they had an opening. I loved teaching there. They liked what I did. And the last 2 years that I was there, I chaired the language department. And I took an early retirement a couple years ago.
And look at where it's brought you now.
See
Beyond
that?
Body Slams 2.0 kicks off in just a couple of weeks in Philadelphia, and it makes its way up this way Saturday night, February 25th.
February 25th.
With that start time that I love, not 7:30.
No, not 7:30. No. 7:35.
That brings back great memories.
Yeah.
Although I'll tell you this, when the show would end at 7:35, when they'd have the Braves baseball is when I'd get hot. I wanted the 2 hours, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
None of this 6:05 to 7:05. Not till 7:35. It needed to end at 8:05. With them usually pushing an Omni show that was 1,000 miles away from me that I couldn't attend. But I liked hearing about it anyway, you know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
I loved knowing what was going on with all the different promotions.
Yeah, and we'll have like memorabilia like you have.
Look
up
at
here.
Some of the great stuff. Now we didn't mention that enough. We got a great t-shirt. I think there's a nice shot of it over my shoulder. That is the official Beyond Body Slam shirt.
It's the tour t-shirt.
Mm-hmm. You're going to have that available in Worcester and all the stops, I imagine.
And all the stops,
okay.
Yep. And you'll be able to pick up the book. But I'll also have things that are collector's items
mm-hmm.
that I won't necessarily want to sell, that people can examine, and like some of these 1970s posters.
Great stuff. I mean, I was looking through them before we started, and it's almost like you got a walking hall of fame. With everything that you took out of your trunk, you know, it was great.
Well, that's because I'm a museum piece.
There you go, one of a kind. But just stuff you'll never see again. We talk about it. Someone can buy it.
Oh.
We mentioned once you get the money for it, you'll never be able to replace something
Gary
like
Michael
that.
Gary Michael Capetta?
You know?
Oh, he's still alive?
I bet you don't get that. Come on now,
You'd
Gary.
Be surprised what I get.
I can only imagine, but that's a different story for a different time. And again, the book, I'm sure you'll be happy to add your John Hancock to it.
Absolutely.
Personalize one of these bad boys for the great fans
Absolutely.
That are going to be with you in Worcester.
It's a $20 admission, and then there's a $40 meet and greet. So if anyone wants to upgrade, they get to enter the theater early, so they get their choice of seat.
Mm-hmm.
They get a free book. They get a free 8x10 tour photo.
Oh, wow.
And then after the show, we'll do photo op and autographs.
It's a great experience. Again, yeah. Like I said, it's not just going to a wrestling show. It's an interactive, engaging experience. I think that's why the fans are really going to take to it once they come out.
And we're going to celebrate being wrestling fans.
Yeah, the Nature Boy's birthday here in Worcester, right?
That's true.
Are you going to ride Space Mountain?
Anything can happen. I told you before, anything can happen.
Unpredictable.
Unpredictable.
And we don't want to send any residual checks down to Gleason's gym. Gary, let me ask you this. We know the answer to it, obviously. But for the fans that may be newer, that didn't get to look maybe at the Attitude Era as old school, what was the glory days of the territory system of the 70s and 80s like? Do you experienced it with Vince McMahon Sr. and Gorilla Monsoon with the WWWF, when it transitioned to Vince and Linda McMahon with the WWF, and even it was still alive into the late 80s in some capacities with the NWA? What was, not to spend an hour on it, but what was the presentation like for these fans that didn't just get it once or twice a year now, like they do when WWE comes to the major markets, not even in some,
right?
Compared to what I consider to be better days for professional wrestling?
I worked all kinds of venues, from rodeo arenas to nightclubs to theaters where we would put the ring on the stage.
Wow.
And there would be maybe two or three rows, would be ringside seats, and then everyone else
on the stage?
Yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Army bases, roller skating rinks, hockey rinks, all kinds of local community venues. High schools, of course, convention centers. In New Jersey, we did all of the shore communities. We talked earlier about that great venue locally.
IBEW Hall in Waltham, Mass.
I love that place.
Wasn't that great?
It was great with the balcony.
Yeah. That went around three quarters of the arena.
It was wonderful.
That's a place we would run if that was still in existence. Like I said, it turned into a temple.
It was everything that was perfect about that
place. And the perfect size, you know, for a smaller promotion.
Yeah.
Or in the territory days, outside of the major arenas, those were the places that a WWE would run on a weeknight, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah. And then when the casinos started to open, then we went into the casinos. I did a series, a little-known live TV series from the Steel Pier in Atlantic City. And it was...
A non-wrestling TV show?
No.
It was wrestling, okay.
Yeah. In fact, it was the first time that Gorilla Monsoon was a commentator.
Really?
It was where he really got the flow and... and then we were in resorts. When I was with the AWA, we did the very first pro wrestling show on ESPN, and it came out of the Tropicana in Atlantic City. Then they moved the show to Las Vegas.
Yeah.
But the very first year, it was slams and jams. It was a roller derby and wrestling.
I think I'm going to guess that the wrestling was doing a little higher of a television rating than the roller derby.
We would hope so. It was a great experience. So you're right. I mean, all of these local, like high schools, colleges.
Were some of the more normal ones.
Yes, they were. I mean, anywhere you could gather a group of people, county fairs, state fairs, you name it, we were there.
Seen it all, done it all, and the fans get to experience everything and then some.
You haven't been a ring announcer unless you've played the Cowtown Rodeo Arena and announced with cow dung up to your ankles. I mean, come on. With a tuxedo, yeah, I mean, I tell you, all kinds of scenarios.
And correct me if I'm wrong, but you kind of tried to relive that with the first book tour that you did. Back in 2001, 2002, as you were going to fairs
boy, that was a big mistake.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, I went to county fairs, I went to state fairs throughout the Midwest.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is because wrestling was developed and originated in the United States at the fairs. It was beat the champ. So you would go, and anyone can go, put up their money, people would bet on whether or not you could beat the carnival brute. So I thought, well, let me bring wrestling back to its roots. Well, move. No. Nobody who's going to a fair to eat junk food and, go to concerts and tumble in the air in these amusement rides. Mm-hmm. They're not thinking about a book.
Yeah.
Oh, no. But what I did do was I scheduled a lot of media avails throughout. So I was on TV shows and radio stations throughout the Midwest and down south. And yeah, so so what I was doing was, since the people weren't coming to see me.
You went to them.
I went to them.
It's like we mentioned, I think, when we chatted on the phone leading up to today. If you were in Boston, it might be tougher to get some play in the media. But when you go to a city like a Scranton, Pennsylvania, or a Worcester, Massachusetts, there's much more excitement about you coming to them.
Yes.
They don't get a Gary Michael Capetta or someone of that stature in all forms of entertainment. As commonplace as it is in a city like Boston or New York City,
yes,
and something like that.
Yeah, I have a couple of radio interviews coming up, one in northern Massachusetts.
Oh, great.
And one in northern Rhode Island. Yeah, I'm looking forward to them. To talk about, you know, the Body Slam show on the 25th in Worcester.
Did you hit New England a lot when you were with WWF, or was you were a more monsoon town
right.
guy, right?
Yeah, every partner, Monsoon was a part owner of the organization, and he was given a geographic territory to promote, and so was Skolin. And New England was Angelo Savoldi. Angelo Savoldi promoted all of up in this area. So I didn't work full time with Angelo. I did a few of Angelo's shows. He also had part of, like, he lived in northern New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
So close to home, I used to do some of his shows.
Oh.
But I mostly did Monsoons, which was New Jersey, Delaware, Eastern Pennsylvania, which included where we shot TV. So
yeah.
That's what got me on the broadcast. A lot of people don't realize, I was with the WWE for 11 years.
11 years, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, long, long stretch.
And for the people that have no idea what a monsoon town was, or may think it was a place that was victimized, the Gorilla Monsoon was a part owner of the WWF territory, as it was known then.
That's right.
And they all had little cities that were exclusive to certain promoters.
Right.
So a monsoon town would be a city that Gorilla Monsoon exclusively promoted.
That's right.
For what is now WWE.
That's right.
English, as opposed to those that have been around this craziness.
That's
from the
that's
inside.
True.
So a monsoon town is not a place in New Jersey that was ravaged by a storm.
Yeah, of course. You know, of course, okay. Once a month on a Monday, you had Madison Square Garden.
Right.
Once a month on a Saturday, you had Philadelphia Spectrum. Boston shows ran, were they Saturdays?
Boston was always a Saturday town.
And I think Pittsburgh was also. You know, so those were the mainstays. And then as time went on, there were Meadowlands came along, then the Nassau Coliseum.
That just reopened. Or is going to reopen pretty soon.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
I wonder how many people realize that Vince McMahon once owned the Cape Cod Coliseum.
I don't know. It's a great fact, though.
Is that still in existence?
I don't know. But he really went out on a limb there with so many things that had nothing to do with professional wrestling. And he learned so much, as wrestling lore goes, about merchandising from different concerts.
Yes.
And different entertainment variety shows that would come through there. And it was a great learning experience for him to own the Cape Cod Melody Tent.
And his dad gave, before that, his dad gave him a couple of towns.
Even further north up in Maine, yeah.
Yes,
Bangor, I think, was his first
right.
city.
That's right. So he learned. And he brought his son Shane in the same way. He would take his son Shane, when he owned the Cape Cod Coliseum, and let's say they had a concert that night, his son Shane was part of the cleanup crew. So he would drive his son Shane out to the parking lot, drop him off. The kid would clean, you know, clean the arena. He wanted him to learn from first
Bottom
base
up.
All the way up.
And I think that's for the best for anybody, whether it's a McMahon or no matter what your last name is.
That's true.
The more you know, the more you appreciate what others do. As it is, professional wrestling isn't always just the two guys in the ring, as you can attest to probably better than anybody. It's a complete team effort.
Absolutely. And you know who the unheralded heroes are? It's the ring crew. The ring crew gets absolutely no credit. And I always made a point of befriending the ring crew. Some of the top wrestlers would use them. And not abuse them, but just like use them. I need a cup of coffee. Go get me this. Go get me that. To go tell someone this. And never thank them. When it's the ring crew that makes their work environment for the evening safe. If something is not put together correctly with the ring, then one of the wrestling superstars could easily
Anything
get hurt.
Anything could happen.
Absolutely. So, the ring crew is, I always bonded with the ring crew.
some of the great champions that were around in the WWF during your time there, especially in the beginning, Bruno Sammartino, Pedro Morales, superstar Billy Graham, Bob Backlund. I'm sure you go into great detail, about, especially I'm sure about Bruno during Beyond Body Slams, the show itself, and especially in the book. Some highlights, a few bullet points about some of those greats for the fans that just right now, I know one thing, I watch a video or I read a book, I love to escape into that time when I really enjoyed it, or I didn't know as much about it as I do now. And then when I come back to reality and I realize that it is the way it is now, it's kind of a letdown. But
I think it's interesting that you seem to be enamored with McMahon Sr.'s territory, and not so much like when I did my work with WCW and the Crocketts. You like to go way back.
I was around to watch all that.
Yeah.
I like to know about the stuff that I didn't witness firsthand, or, you know, a lot of the guys that were around, I can still speak to them. A lot of those guys that were around for the territory version of the WWE, you know, so many have passed on, you know.
Well, Bruno Sammartino was the reason that I became a wrestling fan.
Mm-hmm.
I would watch him on TV, and he would look at me, and he would tell me how he was done dirty. And he would look at me and he said, I need your help. I need for you to come to the arena, to the Newark Armory, the Elizabeth Armory. I did armories too. The convention center, wherever, like small little places. And I need your support. And I believed him. And I had to be there as if my presence was going to help him win. But I believed that as a kid. Now I'm talking about I was 11 years old when I first discovered what I thought was a little pornographic when I first saw it as a 10-year-old or 11-year-old. Because just think of it, it's a darkened arena, and you have these spotlights on these scantily clad people, men, women, men midgets, lady midgets, and they're all sweaty, and they're rolling around, and people are screaming from the sidelines, and some of them looked pretty bizarre. Some of them didn't speak English. So as a little kid, I'm looking at it and I'm saying, I don't know if I should be watching this. You know, maybe this is like adult entertainment. I didn't use those words, but that's what I was thinking. Until after a few weeks, I just said, who cares? This is great.
Nothing like it.
I can't miss this. These people are out of their minds. And that's what drew me in. But Bruno. And Bruno, now the very first night that I announced, he was in the main event. So the thrill of... He was like my Mickey Mantle, my Johnny Unitas. He was everything to me. And the wonderful thing is that as I came to know him, he was a genuine guy. He is the same no matter. He's like a very sensitive guy. He's a very thoughtful guy. When I lost touch with him and I started working with WCW, and then I saw him again, he remembered that I was teaching school. He remembered. And he said, you're working with WCW? He said, full time? He said, are you sure you want to do that? I said, yeah, bro. He was like my uncle. He said, be sure that they take care of you. Be sure they take care of you. I said, yeah, it's okay. Everything's fine. But he was genuinely concerned. And that's my hero. I can't express to you what that means. So he's the real deal. No doubt about it.
As time went on, longtime fans know that Vince McMahon Sr. sold the company off to his son.
Yep.
And his wife. What was the difference working for the different versions of the McMahons?
I didn't see much of a difference because my immediate supervisor was Monsoon.
Mm-hmm.
And Monsoon did become a little discontent because he had his shares pretty much taken from him. They were bought from him, but against his will. There was some kind of technicality in the contract that allowed the McMahons to retrieve those those shares. As Junior took over, I knew that I didn't have a future with the company, which is why I wasn't fired and I didn't quit. I just stopped going. And because I had other opportunities, especially the ESPN opportunity. It was my first national broadcast.
So you didn't have a contract with WWE?
No, never. Mm-mm.
Did you ever think that Linda McMahon would wind up running the Small Business Administration for the United States with under the president.
I think it's interesting, and I have a lot of things to say about it, but I'm going to hold it for
Saturday night, February the 25th, live at Clark University in Worcester, Massachusetts.
People who have heard my interviews over the last few years, they've heard some of my rants. Well, I have some rants. I have some things that I want to talk about. And nobody or nothing is all good or all bad. But I do have some thoughts, some insights, some behind-the-scenes kind of stories about Linda that I think would be apropos now that she's a member of the president's cabinet.
I know you shared some thoughts with me when we did a promotional interview way back in Push the Book in Christmas of 2002, to go back a few years. And some interesting stuff, which I'm sure the fans, again, will enjoy in Worcester or any of the nine big stops throughout February.
Yeah, this is stuff that's not in the book.
And March. No, this was in our interview that
right.
we did on the telephone.
She's a smart cookie. There's no doubt about it. No, she's smart as a tack. Always has been from when she was Finney's young wife. She was the brains. He was the creative control, but she was the brains.
Now, let me ask you this. This is funny. You mentioned in the book you call him Junior. You're not talking about Rikishi, which is his nickname. Junior is referred to by a lot of old-timers as Vince McMahon Jr. What would you refer to him if you ran into him today? What would you say to him? What would you address him as? Vince? Vinny? You knew him as Vinny.
Yeah, probably Vinny.
You throw the Vinny out?
I
like that. All right, let me ask you about another person that's always seems to be in the news an awful lot, Hulk Hogan. We talked about the great champions that we can fantasize about from the 70s. You know, they may be as good as we look back at them as. Maybe they weren't. That's subjective. That's what's great about wrestling. When Hulk Hogan came into the picture for WWF the second time, not when he was the Incredible Hulk Hogan with Freddie Blassie in the early 80s, did you think Hogan could become as big as he eventually did?
No. Because I didn't know that what Vinny had planned as far as marketing goes. It's an interesting question, though. It goes back to the days of the old movie studios, where you had your moguls and you had your stars. Well, could that mogul have been successful in his movie making and box office without that star?
Right.
Could that star have made it without the backing and being put in the position by that mogul? It's the same thing with a Hogan and a McMahon. Could either of them have, could McMahon have found someone else to put in that place? Could someone else have taken Hogan and made him as big as he became?
Well, before he had WWF 2.0 for himself, he had the Rocky movie, and he was drawing some great business for Vern Gagne in the AWA before he gave notice to come to the New York territory.
But we, you know, we came to see that the AWA didn't last.
No.
And I think that if folks take a look at, with a few exceptions, like The Rock, like Steve Austin, when a personality leaves the WWE, usually you don't hear a whole lot about them. It's that rub of that Monday night or Tuesday night show on USA that's needed. They may get a run for the next 6 months, like Cody Rhodes has gotten.
Yep, he's done very well for himself.
Now the question is, can he maintain that? Can he maintain that without that platform? It's very difficult to do.
And another topic, I'm not sure if you're going to include it as part of the show or not, in Worcester on February 25th, but you didn't have a chance to be up close and personal to Hogan's work and, again, explosion. Once you had his early, was it late 70s when he debuted, I think?
Yes.
Late 70s into the early 80s when he was a heel with Freddie Blassie. You get to see a growing Hulk Hogan, no pun intended. You get to see the beginning of the Hulkamania era in WWF when he beat Sheik for the title. And then you get to see it again when a noticeably smaller Hulk Hogan showed up in WCW.
That's right.
You were there for the first year when Hogan came in.
Through his entire career.
So you must have a book worth of Hulk Hogan stories and experiences from all the great events you not only witnessed, but you were in the center ring for.
He's an interesting character. He's smart. He's a smart guy. But I think, even though he had his TV show, if you remember that.
Thunder in Paradise.
Right.
Yep.
And they would tape that show in the next slot over from where we would tape the WCW TVs in the Disney MGM studios. So I got to see him there too.
Mm-hmm.
He was one that was able to, you know, take his wrestling name and, you know, and market it outside. You know who was the first one to do that? Sergeant Slaughter.
Oh, with G.I. Joe.
Yeah, Sergeant Slaughter was, and the reason that he was dismissed from the WWF was Vinny started to market the guys. In the old days, when you went to an arena, you had a program and you had these old faded pictures. That was it.
That was the merchandise table.
That was it. Then in the mid-80s, he came out with the videotapes, the Coliseum series. He started putting out toys, and Sergeant Slaughter spoke up and said, why aren't we getting anything from this? Immediately, he was gone. But he was the first one, like you said, with his tie-in with G.I. Joe. Then he went with Gagne for a little while. He was on the ESPN show that I did. He had a great run. In fact, he was making huge money for independent shows. It was like $2,500 a night.
And they're talking the 80s.
Back in the
80s. Yeah.
Back in the 80s. That's but he drew money.
And to show how much of a no-no that was, you're talking about not just a star. He was known in households around the world through G.I. Joe and from wrestling. And then he just vanished from wrestling out of nowhere, from WWF at least, at that time.
And to the McMahon's credit, he went back and worked with them again. So it's all business. It's all a matter of money. It's if you can draw, I don't care what you've said about me. I don't care what you've done.
The end of the day, it's about how many tickets you can
sell.
You're
welcome back.
You talk about guys that could have possibly been on par with Hogan if given the chance. Gentleman that's been in the news, we recently lost Superfly Jimmy Snuka. You had a lot of altercations with him in yesteryear.
I did, but I don't consider him as someone who Vinny could not have done with Snuka what he did with Hogan.
Now, why is that?
Just his manner of speaking, just his public persona.
Mm-hmm.
Jimmy wasn't really a communicator. I can't see Jimmy going to hospitals. I can't see Jimmy cutting ribbons, you know, with mayors. Hogan is more of a politician.
You couldn't go mainstream with Snuka.
Yeah, not to the extent that you could with Hogan.
To wrestling fans, and again, you were front row for this, how hot was the Superfly at his peak before his issues took over?
Oh, yeah, he was huge.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Those Roddy Piper, Jimmy Snuka rivalries, matches, they were incredible. You know, you mentioned that I was there and up front for these things. If I could just talk a little bit about ring announcers of today.
Sure.
And what I've seen, because I've done guest ring announcing in different parts of the country.
Did it for us here in the Millennium Wrestling Federation.
What's that?
You did it here for us in the Millennium Wrestling Federation back in 02.
This is true. And we have great announcers. We have really good ring announcers, guys that are honing their craft. I had an advantage because I was the only one in my territory that was a ring announcer, because I was Monsoon's ring announcer.
Right.
So no one else had an opportunity to get good at what they were doing. So I go out and I do guest announcings, which means I'll go out and announce a main event or a championship match, and the promotions announcer does the rest of the show. And I sit there and I watch, and they're doing a terrific job in the ring. But when they get out of the ring, sometimes the phone comes out. Sometimes they start talking to someone at ringside, and I'm saying, what are you doing? Like, you have to show, as long as you're within those gates and you're within view of the public, you need to be concentrating on what's going on in the ring. You need to show that that's important. Because if it's not important to you and you're going to sit there with your phone, how do you expect the person that's sitting behind you
to take it? Right, in the front row.
Right. So I have two messages. One to ring announcers. Get with the program. Watch what's going on. That's part of your job. And react to what's going on.
Sell.
And to young wrestlers, do me a favor. And if you have a ring announcer who does what I just described, you take him by the collar in the back and you teach him. You tell him, look, if you don't think that what I'm doing, because I'm working my butt off in the ring, If you don't think what I'm doing is important, please, just leave ringside then, and then come back at the end to announce the winner. But don't distract from what I, because that's a distraction from what's really important. Ring announcers need to realize we're second bananas. We're supporting players. No one ever bought a ticket to go see a wrestling show
right. Because
Gary Michael Capetta was the ring announcer. They never tuned in on TV and said, oh, wait a minute, Gary's not announcing. Oh, I'm not watching that. I mean, that's silly. Until February 25th, I've never sold a ticket. But that's old school, but it's important.
Sure, like we mentioned a little earlier, it's a team effort. The ring crew, if you don't have the ring crew, you don't have a show. You don't have a ring announcer, you don't have any introductions to tell people who's coming out.
If you don't have an advance man, you have nobody that knows about the show and comes to see it.
Exactly.
Everybody is important.
Total package.
Yes.
I lost track of where the heck I was. We were talking
about... You haven't looked at your notes once, this entire interview.
I think you predicted this when we spoke about it on the phone, that it was going to turn into a great conversation. And I tell you, the better interviews we've done are better than, well, in August of 1983, Jimmy Snuka took on Don Morocco. I think that gets a little tedious.
I can take the notes and I'll interview you. Would it be interesting to see what your answers would be if you were me?
You know, I tell you, that was Paul Bearer always wanted to do that because he loved my off-camera remarks about a lot of things about wrestling and in life. I miss that guy, but he's with us in spirit.
There you go.
The Superfly Jimmy Snuka. What a sad passing. Stomach
yes.
cancer. You know, you had the murder trial that didn't even happen. But to me, he was a guy I worked with. I got to meet with Tony Rumble, CWA. He was on the very first event we had in the MWF back in 2001. And we actually had a Jimmy Snuka appreciation night in 2013. You know what I found funny? I don't know how much you kept in touch with him over the years, but I thought he was a lot more with it in 2013 than he ever was in the 90s.
Mm.
I mean, you could have a real conversation with him beyond lovely, brother. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Other than the night that he tried to strip my clothes off me in the middle of the ring on TV, we had a good relationship.
You and the villains had some interesting encounters. I know George Steele was another nemesis of yours, I think.
Absolutely. Wasn't he? Yeah, I didn't know what was going on at the time. George Steele, I was terrified of George Steele, legit terrified of the guy. And it's exactly what the way he wanted it to be. Now that I look back, I understand they were using me as a prop. But I'm thankful for that because it drew attention to someone where attention didn't usually go. I was only supposed to go in there, introduce the guys, and then re-enter the ring and announce the winner. But they brought a lot of attention, which I don't think Vinny appreciated. And I don't know why he didn't tell them, just leave the kid alone. You know, like leave him. He may have, and they didn't listen to him. I'm not sure.
It helped get him over, but, you know?
Yeah, yes. And they were using me to do that. And they were bringing notoriety to me by doing that. Because it wasn't just on TV, it was at house shows.
Right.
George Steele would chase me every night I would try to introduce him. Sometimes, you know, to the balcony, sometimes to the concession stands. And I found out why. Years later, I found out why he did what he did. There was a reason, actually. People are not gonna believe this. They're not gonna understand it because it's such old school mentality. The very first time that he was in, that I was to introduce him for TV, I went up to him. And these are George's words. He said, "You came up to me and you said to me, where should I tell the people you're from, and where should I tell the people, what should I tell the people you weigh?" He said, "That insulted me." I said, "George, I don't understand." He said, "Because by saying, where should I tell the people you're from, you're telling me that I'm fake. And I was going to prove to you that I was not fake. So I terrorized you for the next 10 years." And he did. I met him years later in St. Louis in an airport.
Mm-hmm.
WWE was going one direction, WCW was going the other, but we just crossed paths
mm-hmm.
in changing. And I got to see him and talk to him about this. So I found out.
I heard he took Yale. I hope he's doing better. I like him.
I hope he's doing well, too.
Really
good man.
Great guy. Well, we touched upon it a little bit with your various careers in life, but you said you got a feeling once the Vince McMahon era, Vincent K. McMahon era took over, that the writing was kind of on the wall. As that happened, did you worry that that might be the end of Gary Kapeter in wrestling?
Sure.
Did you?
Absolutely. Because he took it national, he stopped going to the local high schools and the local arenas. So that void was filled by independent wrestling.
Right.
So that gave me an opening because people knew me from TV and they knew me as the WWF announcer. So I was sought after in these no-name shows. That was a help to me. And
right.
That's what introduced me to the NWA, because they were doing a tour of northern New Jersey and New York boroughs. And they were using the same promoters that now had no association with the WWF, because they had gone on to bigger arenas all over the world.
Right.
And each promoter would called me up and brought me in.
That's a great place to take a break right now. Again, a countdown is on to February the 25th, the Saturday night, Clark University in Worcester, 7:35 p.m. bell time, although I don't even know if you're going to have a bell.
And you're doing that without notes.
I have notes, but I can't read them.
Oh, okay.
My vision is so bad. and people think my body's bad. My God, you should see it through my eyes. We'll take a brief time out now. Go out, get a refreshment. We come back, we'll talk more about Beyond Body Slams, a little AWA and NWA.
Sounds good to me.
Sounds good, folks. We'll be back after this brief timeout. Stay tuned.
Are you part of a nonprofit organization looking to raise cash for your cause? Don't settle for cheap imitations. After this video, learn how you can bring the action and excitement of the Millennium Wrestling Federation to your town live to help put the fun into fundraising with the superstars and legends of yesterday, today, and tomorrow. This winter, don't miss Gary Michael Capetta's Beyond Body Slams event when it comes to your city live. Fun, informative, controversial, Beyond Body Slams is an insider's romp through professional wrestling with backstage video and stories from Gary's Body Slams autobiography. The tour kicks off February the 19th in Philadelphia, Friday, February 24th in Scranton, Pennsylvania, Saturday, February the 25th in Worcester, Massachusetts, Saturday, March the 4th in Indianapolis, Indiana, Sunday, March the 5th in Chicago, Illinois. Sunday, March the 12th in Greensboro, North Carolina. Saturday, March 18th in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Saturday, March the 25th in Baltimore, Maryland. Culminating WrestleMania weekend at WrestleCon in Orlando, Florida. Visit facebook.com/GMCForReal for complete event information. From WWE to the NWA, from WCW to Ring of Honor, every company and every superstar in between, Gary Michael Capetta brings it to life in Beyond Body Slams Live.
The Millennium Wrestling Federation's 15th anniversary tour begins this fall and rolls into 2017 throughout New England, down the East Coast, and into the Carolinas. If your nonprofit organization is looking for an interactive, turnkey experience while putting the fun into fundraising, you've met the perfect tag team partner. MWF offers a variety of packages for groups of almost any size, from our live events at the Boston Garden, the Kowloon Entertainment Dining Complex, and the legendary Suffolk Downs, to high school gyms and function halls. We've presented live events everywhere. Since 2001, the MWF's mission has been simple: keep the kids off the streets. Under the leadership of President Dr. David Reese, we bring the superstars of yesterday, today, and tomorrow to your town, not for a quote-unquote wrestling show, but an event that features action-packed in-ring wrestling, autograph and pose photo opportunities, question and answer sessions, and much more. It is the best of sports and entertainment. The week of your event, we can add on to the endeavor with anti-bullying campaigns, library meet and reads, youth sport concussion seminars, and more. Our live events are fit for fans of every age, from 5 to 95. This fall, as part of our new Kids Club program, we offer live event experiences exclusively for the youngest of fans. On the flip side, we can also produce a tailor-made event for fans of an older demographic as well. We work with you every single step of the way to get the word out to fans near and far, on our local television offerings, and to over 50,000 fans and growing on our social media platform. Your success is our success. If your group has had enough of boring candy bar and wrapping paper sales and has the energy to team with our passionate fan base, bringing the MWF experience to your community is the answer to put smiles on faces while raising cash for your cause. Contact us today to get the ball rolling for your custom-made event that you want to bring back year after year. Don't just take it from us. Here are folks we've teamed with in the past.
already know, Kowloon Restaurant, established in 1950 and spanning four generations, serves a multi-Asian menu. Did you also know that Kowloon Restaurant is New England's premier Asian dining and entertainment complex, serving Cantonese, Szechuan, Thai, and Polynesian cuisine? And did you know that Kowloon Restaurant is also the home of the finest Japanese sushi? If you haven't dined at Kowloon Restaurant lately, then you simply haven't dined at Kowloon. Kowloon Restaurant, Route 1 North in Saugus.
Wrestling fans, welcome back here with the man, the myth, the legend, the world's most dangerous ring announcer. Who do you know that has a nickname like that? We're talking about Gary Michael Capetta coming to visit us here in the Northeast once again. Saturday night, February the 25th, special 7:30, 5 p.m. start time for the Beyond Body Slams tour. Gary, it's been great having you here, and we're looking even more forward to seeing you again in just a few weeks.
And when we're at the university, you may find out why I'm called the world's most dangerous announcer.
You know, I'm almost scared to hear that, Gary. We talked about you being this nice, mild-mannered guy, and now you're throwing this out at us.
Well,
all just, in black.
You never know. You never know.
All right. Well, we talked what got you into wrestling, your career outside of wrestling, your time with the McMahons and the WWF, mm-hmm. and then when Vincent K. McMahon took over. What a lot of fans nowadays, they may remember you more for than that, is the time you spent in NWA/WCW along with your appearances on cable with the AWA.
Yep. When I left the WWF and I went to the NWA, mm-hmm. it was like witnessing going from ballet to backstreet brawls.
Really?
Yeah, it was night and day. Because they worked so light, like Hogan worked so light in the WWF. And, you know, you had your Tully Blanchard and your Ric Flair and your Arn Anderson, and they were brutal. Manny Fernandez and Ronnie Garvin, Jimmy Garvin, the Freebirds, the Road Warriors. It was an incredible roster.
And what we kind of talked about in the beginning, fans loved both, because variety, there was a difference between the two.
That's true. That's true.
What did you prefer? What style? Or did you have a preference?
Yeah. You know, the WWF was exciting to me because it was my first opportunity to announce in front of 20,000 people and to be on television. But the in-the-arena experience with the NWA and then WCW, there was an intensity there that couldn't be duplicated anywhere else. Those storylines were so tight. People were so wound up to see the rivalry and how it was going to end in their arena, in their city. There's nothing like that. Because you feed off of the people.
Sure.
You know, when the people are wound up and they're on their feet and they're screaming and the guys are just walking down the aisle, you know it's only going to go through the roof from there.
That Carolina fan base is out of this world, as I mentioned to you from the shows that we've had down there here in the Millennium Wrestling Federation. What? Again, passionate fans, great fans, they love wrestling.
Yeah.
And when you didn't give them Broadway versions of pro wrestling, when you were giving them that violent, action-packed, bloody wrestling with the intense storylines and whatnot, must have been some magic nights at the ringside table.
And that's why I decided to bring the show, the stage show, to Greensboro. Because we're by Raleigh and Winston-Salem. And Greensboro in the middle, and
it's the Worcester in North Carolina.
I tried to spot the shows so that more people could get to them. In the case of Massachusetts, Boston, like I said before, Boston and Providence, Springfield, Worcester, Hartford, all within good distance.
It's going to be a happening if you're in North Carolina. We have a great fan base down in North Carolina, so Greensboro. It's certainly worth making the trek out to see Beyond Body Slams. I believe that one's in March.
That one is, yes, March 12th. March
12th Saturday
in Greensboro.
Saturday night, March the 12th, 7:35 p.m. bell time there, too?
You're testing me. No, that's a matinee.
A matinee,
we'll be going at 3:05.
Wow, all right. Well, hey, TBS went that way from time to time,
too. It's a Sunday afternoon.
And again, you can check out the link and all the graphics we have on the screen. And you can check out Gary on Facebook at GMC4Real.
GMC number 4Real. Go to the event page and all of the stage show happenings are listed. And you just click and it'll take you to eventbrite.com.
And you know, another thing you can do, and not everybody does this, but if you're excited about the event like I am, you can click on up to 500 of your friends through a simple invite button
We talked about your days in Ring of Honor, which was, you know, I definitely wouldn't call that an independent, but look at where the guys that you were able to see in arenas that were drawing 500, 600, 700 people, and look at where they are right now.
Yeah, and you know, fans,
some of the biggest stars in the profession.
Fans that go to the independent shows and they see these wrestlers grow, they have a stake in their career. You know, so it's really cool that you can go to a local arena, see a wrestler, and then just a few years later, you're going to a huge arena. You're going to a Coliseum, and you're tuning in on Monday or Tuesday night, and you're seeing them on television.
75,000 to 100,000 fans at WrestleMania.
Yep. I used to do that with singers. I would go to like a local club, and I saw a lot of people who became very famous later in a very local setting.
Grassroots level.
Yeah.
That's what it's all about, baby. You got to earn a living. The only way you can do that is with all the fan support you can muster up for a great product. The hungry young athletes that want it just as bad as the guys that are delivering, as you mentioned, on Monday and Tuesday nights.
I'm still waiting for you to go to your notes.
Oh, they're not even on my lap anymore. I mean, I've really done away with those. One thing I wanted to ask you, we mentioned your time in AWA.
Yes, sir.
Now, a lot of people that must watch that on WWE Network that are fans of the modern product and the ring worker today must be like, you know, these guys are dinosaurs for the most part, outside of your Rockers and your Kurt Hennings and whatnot. What was the magical appeal of the AWA to fans that didn't live it in its current form back in the heyday?
I don't know the answer to that question because I don't know that there was a magical appeal. Vern Gagne was very successful in his territory when he had his territory. But once he went outside and he had competition that came into his territory is when he started to lose ground. It's not to say that it wasn't a terrific product.
Mm-hmm.
It was for the folks that were there in Chicago and Minneapolis and so forth. But he didn't have the background of competing with anyone. So even though he gave them a terrific wrestling product, he didn't know how to counter program. It's one of the reasons that wrestling at the Tropicana in Atlantic City didn't last past a year. And they just weren't happy with what was going on.
Was it just kind of a stale product or?
They weren't drawing, first off, they weren't drawing ratings on ESPN.
Oh, okay.
And second, they weren't, the casino had spotters. And this was on a weeknight.
Mm-hmm.
And they would watch where people would go at the end of the wrestling show. And
they
were going
home. Yeah.
They had kids. They had to go to school the next morning. They had to go to work the next morning. They weren't going and they weren't gambling. So that was another problem that they had at the Tropicana.
What led to it, and this again, I find this to be fascinating because it was before I started watching. What led to them going to Vegas? What was the reason behind that?
That was closer to their territory, and I think that they had to find another venue. I don't know the inside of why Vegas, why it was the showboat that they went to.
Did you do the Vegas shows too?
No, because I was teaching school.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so as soon as they left Atlantic City, Vern brought me in for a couple pay-per-views.
Oh, the Super Clashes.
Yeah, I went to Super Clash and Wrestle Rock.
Wrestle Rock 86, yep, okay.
He was very good to me. I liked Vern a lot. He was always came through with what he promised. He was always a gentleman to me.
Mm-hmm.
He was a classy guy.
I like watching the old AWA. Again, when I was a kid, my gosh, you had the WWE, you had NWA, you had ESPN's AWA, and then the ESPN World Class shows.
Mm-hmm.
What more could you want as a wrestling fan? You talk about, and all four of them were completely different. Different wrestlers, different styles, and I loved them all.
Yeah.
That's and
you
what
made,
I think I wish we'd see more of today.
You made reference of the AWA on the WWE Network, and just about all of my body of work is on the WWE Network, right? Because they own the NWA stuff, the WCW stuff, their own stuff, the AWA stuff. There's just a few indie promotions that I had worked for that did television that the WWE doesn't own. But what I'm impressed with is when I go to conventions or I'll meet at the show in Worcester, younger people, and they don't know me from announcing currently, so they look and they study the old tapes. And it's amazing how educated the younger fan is.
I've heard so many of the guys say that in recent years, ever since the network launched.
Yep.
Between that and YouTube, too.
Yep.
You know, how surprised and taken aback they are that these young fans know so much about them and how familiar they are with the career, sometimes even more than they remember themselves, you know?
I'll tell you a funny story. When I was working, 10 years ago when I was working with Ring of Honor, we had a show in Philadelphia, and I live not too far from Philly, within an hour. And Daniel Bryan, he didn't have a place to sleep that night. So he came over to the house and to sleep on the couch. I brought out my NWA tapes and DVDs. And I have a big screen TV, you know, which is meant to be viewed from a distance. No. He sat right in front, right under the screen. And he's watching he was watching Arn Anderson.
Wow.
And at a certain point, I said to him, like, do you want something to eat or you want something to drink? And like, I didn't exist. His eyes were just glued to the set. And when he was finished, when the match was finished, I said to him, are you okay? He said, please, you never interrupt an Arn Anderson match. And he hadn't have an attitude or anything. He was just enthralled with and studying what he was watching there.
Okay, he's a great one. We actually had him here, and let me tell you this event now. Here in the MWF, we had him not only when he was with WWE, but when he was actually the United States champion. Also, this is the only time it ever happened in wrestling history that I know of. Daniel Bryan, WWE U.S. champion. We had Jay Lethal when he was the TNA X division, and Eddie Edwards when he was the Ring of Honor champion, all on the same show.
Wow.
That took a little navigation. Awesome Kong was on the show. It was her last match before she went to WWE. Paul Bearer was back managing Kane part-time on WWE TV. Abyss was in TNA. It was crazy, but it was a hell of an event.
You're a promotional wizard.
Two blocks from here. You probably drove by it when you got a little lost.
Excellent.
Yeah, that was a great January of 2011. That was one of the best ones we put on. I mean, if we can ever come do half of that, what can I say? But I know one thing that is going to be promotional brilliance. Saturday, February the 25th, Beyond Body Slams. Gary, you got to take it home for us, brother. We got to get the fans out there again. You got to remember, much like this studio, it's a very intimate setting. There aren't a heck of a lot of seats.
Yes. And it's, once again, it's an interactive show. The fans are part of the show. We're going to celebrate being wrestling fans. We're going to share how we got involved in being wrestling fans. I'm going to tell you a lot of stories from my Body Slams book.
Wonderful book.
And things that I couldn't put in the book. And then I'm going to show you video. We're going to have Q&A. We're going to have, it's like a wrestling match. It's loosely scripted. And I once in a while I go on rants.
And it's not fake.
No. This is the real deal. This is a side of GMC that, by watching me as a ring announcer, you've never seen. You've always seen the very conservative, very serious kind of guy. And I am. And you'll see that side. But I'm also very passionate with my love of wrestling. And I know that many of the fans out there are too. And I want you to come on out. We're going to have a good time. We're going to learn a little bit. And dancing girls? I don't know. Not on stage, but maybe in the audience.
Not too many, because again, it's an intimate setting.
This is true.
Although with you and the ladies, the dancing girls, I don't want you to get too intimate, Gary. It's not that type of a show.
It's February 25th at Clark University, Razo Hall. And it's we're going to have a great time.
Anyone that knows Angry Me knows that I don't put over anything unless it's something I truly believe in. I truly believe in this book. I truly believe in the show, February 25th. And I totally endorse this as a great
person and a true talent.
And a credit to the professional wrestling industry.
Thank you very much.
Gary, I think we probably could have gone another 2 or 3 hours, but we're out of time. How about that?
I'm ready. Let's do it.
A return match, brother. You said you got an idea for a few more tours. We'll have to do it again. Wrestling fans, for Gary Michael Capetta, I'm Dan Marotti. We'll see you soon. Don't miss a day on the BostonWrestling.com Supersite as we count down to all the festivities down south as we head towards WrestleMania season. Till we speak again, you and yours, be well.